Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this MS Focus Town Hall meeting. We're very delighted that you could be with us today to ask questions of our panel and learn more about what the MS Focus Multiple Sclerosis Foundation can do for you. So to start with, I'd like to have our panel members introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about what they do. One of our panelists is still dealing with a technical issue, trying to connect, so hopefully she'll be able to join us as we begin. But I'd like to start with our special guest, our team member and friend, Sherry Binns. Sherry, would you tell everyone a little bit about yourself and about what you do?
Sure. I am a registered nurse certified in MS nursing. I have had MS myself for easily 45 years, although I was diagnosed about 30 years ago. Living far more successfully with it now than I was 20 years ago with a lot of help from this particular group. You also may know me as the administrator of our public Facebook page and the MS Focus Confidential Facebook page, which is for people living with MS, not for significant others or family members, but only for the individual living with MS. And so I'm here today to answer your questions related to quality of life with MS, lifestyle changes, maybe what you can tweak to feel a little bit better.
Okay. All right. And Sherry's very modest. She didn't mention she's also a regular contributor to MS Focus Magazine, msfocusmagazine.org, and a member of the Foundation's MS Lived Experience Advisory Panel. She volunteers to do so much for us and for the MS community, and we're delighted that she could be with us for this program. Thank you, Sherry, for bringing your wealth of knowledge. And now we'll introduce Derek Lee. Derek, would you please tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do for the foundation?
Hi, how you guys doing today? Derek Lee, I am the Associate Director of Quality of Life Programs and Services. In a nutshell, I kind of manage our toll-free support line and kind of oversee some of the programs that we deal with kind of day-to-day. I'm sure we'll kind of go over those today. And I'm so excited to be here on this town hall with you guys.
And Derek, how long have you been with the foundation now?
Like 185 years. I'm so sorry.
Not counting 2020, that drops it by 100 years, right?
There you go. So I've been with the foundation since February of 1999, and it's been such a wonderful journey. Proud to still be with the foundation.
Thank you so much. We'll come back to you shortly with some questions that we've gotten in advance. Now, Cheryl, let's see if your audio is working. Cheryl Patterson, would you please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your background with the foundation?
Can you hear me?
We can.
I'm using my cell phone for the audio because something is happening with my laptop. Anyway, good afternoon to all. My name is Cheryl Patterson, and I am the associate director of two wonderful programs, the emergency grant assistance and the home care grant assistance. And I've been with the foundation just a little bit behind Derek. So I started in the year 2000. So this year is my 21st year. So I totally enjoy what we're doing, what we do there. And I don't, the home care department, if you guys do not know, we offer home care across the whole nation and Puerto Rico and any, basically most US territories like the Virgin Islands, et cetera. And the emergency grant assistance, what we do in that program is we will help pay for utilities or rent, et cetera, when a client is going through a crisis or has lost their job, et cetera, while they're waiting on a disability to kick in. I'm sure we'll talk more later about what we all do. Thank you.
Okay, so as we begin, I just want to let our audience know, if you have a question, there are a couple of ways that you can address that question to our panelists. You can click the chat button in your app or on your screen and type that question in, and I'll be happy to read that out. Or you can use the raise hand feature. If you are on a computer, you'll find that under the participants menu. If you are on a device, you'll find it by clicking the button on your screen that says more, dot, dot, dot. And when you click raise hand, I will send you a request to please unmute, and you will have to hit the button on the screen that allows me to unmute you. We also have a few questions that we received in advance, so I'm gonna go ahead and get started with some of those. So Derek, let's start with you. There have been a lot of questions as the temperatures are getting warmer about cooling. Can you talk a little bit about the cooling program, who is eligible, when it runs, and how that program works?
Sure. So the cooling program runs February 1st to June 1st. And we always get that question, you know, why do you run the program, you know, that early? It's usually still cold in early February, but we like to get a jump on trying to get those cooling vests out to the public. So by the summer, which is usually the peak of the hot months, the vests are already out there. And if we have any troubleshooting issues that we have to deal with, we have plenty of time throughout the rest of the year to deal with that. And anyone who has multiple sclerosis is eligible to apply for the program. And we do try to encourage folks to apply. You know, we have some repeat offenders, which is okay, because a lot of times your cooling vests might get faulty, or you may need some replacements. So we don't discourage folks from asking about that. We have some really cool vendors that work with us all year long to help address those issues.
Okay, so if folks want to apply before that June 1st deadline,
go on our website, msfocus.org, and you're gonna go to the Get Help tab. Once you get to the Get Help tab, you can basically find all of our programs that we have available under that Get Help tab. You can either print the application out, or you can apply right then and there. You can apply electronically online for the vest as well.
And while we're talking about cooling, Sherry, let's switch over to you for a second. When people are applying for our cooling program, they have a variety of choices. Do you have any insight on what kind of cooling attire works best in what circumstances that you'd like to share?
Yeah, if the evaporative cooling products are probably the most versatile, as far as if you're traveling or you want something very lightweight. They are moisture activated, so you just wet the product and shake off the excess water, and then put it on, and it cools you by evaporation. Here in New England, where our humidity is so high in the summer, the evaporative cooling products really don't work, because the air just won't accept any more water. So you just feel wet. Opportunity to spend a month in India several years ago, very, very dry climate, and the evaporative products worked beautifully there. I'm extremely heat sensitive and have been for decades. And I find that the most effective vest for me, if I have to be outdoors for long periods of time, more than a couple of hours, are the steel vest products. They are also the heaviest. They weigh about 7 pounds with the cooling inserts in them. But as I was telling Derek before, as we were doing sound checks, what I find is that as it's on my body, the weight is very evenly distributed. And even though fatigue is often a huge factor, the weight of the steel vest does not add to the fatigue, at least for me. And it's not tiring at all to wear. Probably the nicest vests that I have are those from Polar Products. They're what is called a fashion vest, and they zip up the front. They're not overly adjustable. They have a pocket in them, and there are smaller cooling packs that are thinner than what the steel vest packs are. I find if it's 75 or 80 degrees outside, I can wear that vest for maybe an hour and a half before the inserts melt. So I go online and buy an extra set of cooling inserts for that. It's pretty inexpensive to just have another set frozen if you need them. I think steel is about that. It may have changed. It was about $40 the last time I ordered the replacement inserts for them. And I think they're about $28 for Polar Products. So we have, with our application process, products from all of those vendors. And so you need to decide if you need a cooling vest. If you live in a very moist climate with high humidity, you're going to want probably the Cool Max or frozen packs that go in. If you tend to be cool sensitive, you might want to go with phase change. It doesn't get as cold as frozen. You can recharge those just by putting them in the refrigerator, and they offer good cooling for maybe an hour. So it'll get you over a hump if you've got to be outside for any period of time.
Thank you, Sharon. Okay, our next question is from Sandra in the chat. Derek or Cheryl, maybe one of you will jump on this. What type of income is the requirement to qualify for a grant or assistance?
Derek, would you like to go first and then I'll...
Oh, it's up to you, Shakri. You can go.
Okay. So for home care, we do review the income, but we do not... we're not very strict on whether you have a home or may have some savings or bonds, because a lot of times when people apply to us, they have been using home care already for a while and they've been paying out of pocket. So we will consider helping you. It is temporary, because we know that we figure you need to have some quality of life so that you can get a break from paying for that home care. We will still consider you. And so basically you have to have a lot of money sitting in your disposable income at the end of the month, basically, for us to disqualify you. It's usually a very easy approval for home care. With the emergency assistance grant, it is a little different. With the emergency assistance grant, we do have to get your income. We have to basically see a proof of that income and see the reason why, you know, we go over your circumstance. How did you get into the situation? Was it that you were laid off, or you had to take off due to the MS diagnosis, or you may have just be going through a really hard time and you really cannot meet it that month because you had a circumstance such as a car repair or a family member passed away. There's a lot of ways you can qualify for the emergency grant assistance, but it is a little bit more stringent than the home care program.
Derek, anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I'll just say ditto to exactly what Cheryl said. It really is, we don't discourage anyone from applying for assistance because, you know, that's where the coordinator has the ability to reach out to the client to kind of go over every circumstance. So really kind of, you know, kind of following exactly what Cheryl said. So we don't discourage, we want to see everybody so that we can at least talk to you and see what type of assistance you're looking for.
Right. I always explain it that there is no set income limit, that what we're looking at is a patient's disposable income, what's left at the end of the month. Because we recognize that MS is a very expensive disease to treat, that it costs you a whole lot. So no matter what your income is, we don't really look at that. We look at what you are left with after you deal with all your expenses. Would you say that's accurate?
Yes, yeah, 100%. That's absolutely dead on.
Okay. All right, let's see. Next question. Can I get some help with cleaning, laundry, or food prep? Cheryl, would you like to tackle that one?
Yes, absolutely. That is exactly what we do. And definitely errands, someone can go shopping for you to get your food if necessary. That exactly what you requested. Sorry, exactly what you requested is what we do. So please feel free to apply or reach out and call and ask, speak to anyone in the home care department. We'll be glad to assist you through the process.
Okay. Sherry, in terms of living your life with MS and dealing with the fatigue, for things like doing laundry and food prep and doing chores, what can people do to manage their energy and be able to make the most of the time that they have to do these things?
It doesn't take any more time to prepare a meal for 10 than it does for 2. If you're making the same ingredients. So I will often do a large portion that I cook and freeze for future meals so that I don't have to cook in the future. And just portion those meals out in meal-sized portions in the freezer. The other thing that I kept hearing and I kept balking at was don't stand at the counter. Put a chair or a stool there or sit at the table to do your work. And I have to tell you, it makes a huge difference. If you're fighting fatigue, particularly if it's warm, a lot of people listening may have central air. We don't. You may be able to tell from my backdrop, we live in a very old home. Cheryl's been in it. it's mid-1800s that it was built. And so it's probably not as well insulated as some of the newer homes to keep the heat out. We have no ducts. Everything is forced hot air through radiators, steam radiators. So there's no way to put in central air conditioning. So we rely on fans here. And I have to tell you that cooking during the summertime can be really challenging, which is why I'll put a cooling vest on and I'll prepare a meal for 5 different meals and freeze portions of it. And I'll sit at the table if I've got a chop rather than standing at the counter. So little tips like that. Another tip that I found really helps if I've got to clean the bathtub, it's difficult for me, particularly as I get older, to get down on my knees and really scrub that tub. It's painful. And I've found that a sponge mop makes a huge improvement in my access. I can use the leverage of the mop handle to really get in there and dig. I can use that little rough bar on the edge of the sponge to get any rings out of the tub. It helps me to get up and down the walls of the tub. So I would encourage you to invest in an inexpensive sponge mop and let that do a lot of the work for you. As far as laundry is concerned, I'm very fortunate to have my laundry on the living level of the house. So I hold on, David just walked through the house. We're in the midst of a live webinar.
Oh.
And I'm speaking. If y'all want to meet David, hop down next to me.
Well, hi, Derek.
Hey, David, how
I'm
you doing?
I'm the floating head.
Hi, Dave.
Hi, how are you doing? Good to see you, Casey.
Good to see you, too.
Hi, Dave.
Hello.
And Cheryl.
Oh, Cheryl. Good to see you.
Yeah. All right, well, I'm going to let you go because we're in the midst of question and answer
here. Can I just take over?
No.
All right. Yeah. I can tell what I'm not wanting.
All right, so as far as laundry is concerned, I'm fortunate to have it on the same living level, so I don't have to go up and downstairs. But if you've got somebody that can take the laundry down or up for you, can carry the baskets. Just make that an assignment to, if you're living alone and you've got a kid that wants to come in and help, have them do that. And just plan your time out so that you can do the laundry in increments. Sorry for the interruption there, but I thought you might want to see one of the reasons why I'm doing so well.
Absolutely. Caregivers, care partners are super important.
Yes.
Deborah commented, what a great idea, Sherry. I'm going to go buy a new sponge mop head. I agree. It's a terrific idea. Okay. Our next question. I need a ride to a doctor's appointment or sometimes for shopping or a haircut. Is there anything out there to help? Derek, would you like to field that?
Sure. So we do have a transportation program. We do help pay for paratransit. Usually paratransit is available through your local county. But we also partner with Lyft and Uber specifically for doctor's appointments, infusion appointments right now. So we don't utilize the Lyft and Uber for grocery shopping yet, but right now it is specifically, you know, for neurology appointments and infusions where we can assist you. And again, that the application is right on our website, msfocus.org. Go to the Get Help tab. You guys will probably hear me say this a lot during this town hall, but that's where you can find all the programs that we have available.
Okay. That raises a question about driving. Some people kind of wonder, when is the right time to stop driving? How do they know when they shouldn't be driving? Sherry or Derek, do you have any thoughts on that?
I think if you're feeling hesitant yourself, if you're feeling like maybe you're not safe, that's a huge cue right there. Because by the time you're feeling hesitant, others in the car with you have felt that way for a while. And may be very hesitant to say, you know, you might want to let somebody else drive or consider not driving until you're feeling a little stronger. If your vision is impaired, again, that's something you need to consider, particularly nighttime driving. Vision with optic neuritis tends to be a lot worse at night. And so after dusk is often more treacherous. I would say if you've had a minor incident, like just a little fender bender, or you've pulled forward over the cement curb in the parking lot and scraped the underside of your car, if that's happened more than once in the space of a year, that's a cue that it's probably time to give up the keys, because your depth perception's off. And if your depth perception's off, there's a far greater chance of an accident or injury for yourself or others.
Yep. Casey, if I can jump in there too, to just say, you really have to be honest with yourself, right? Meaning that you know that things are a little bit different if you're driving. And, you know, you can even, you know, don't be afraid to contact your local DMV, because there is testing available to see where you are. So it's not like immediate, like saying, okay, we want to take away your license. That's not it. You know, there's different training, and, you know, through our assistive technology program, we even assist with some driving evaluations. So it's important to just, you know, be honest with yourself to say, hey, listen, maybe things are a little bit iffy when it comes to my driving. And that's where you want to just, you want to ask questions, you know, is it time for me to put the, you know, to stop? Maybe you can be creative with what you need to do versus putting yourself in danger.
I think too, if your lower extremities are very weak, you need to probably consider hand controls and getting the training for the hand controls, because you're not safe getting from the gas to the brake quickly enough or forcefully enough to prevent an accident. If you are using a wheelchair, then you probably need some modifications to your vehicle in order to safely drive. So I know several people who use a chair all the time, and they are able to, you know, get the chair into the back seat or the back end of the car, use the car to balance themselves to get around to get into the driver's seat. But their leg strength is so iffy that they probably shouldn't be driving, at least not without some additional equipment. And I think we can help with the foundation for getting that adaptive equipment for hands, you know, for driving with hand controls instead of foot controls.
Yep. So. I'll say one more, cognition. So if you're forgetting where you're going, or having trouble remembering where you're going, it might be a good idea to consider taking less trips or actually giving up the driving, you know, altogether. If you're having trouble with your cognition, not to say completely stop, but if you forget where you're going, that can be really dangerous for you.
I want to dovetail on top of that as well. I have had a couple of instances where after a physical therapy appointment, I've been so wiped out and even overheated that driving is difficult. When I get overheated, my vision goes wonky. And I found that just cranking the air conditioner in the car up and cooling off before I take off and keeping plenty of water in the car, hydrating well, can sometimes clear the head a little bit. There have been times when after an appointment like that, I've had to pull off to the side of the road and say, wait a minute, I don't recognize where I am. And home is a straight shot from here.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're having those moments, I recommend that you cool as quickly as possible, that you hydrate. And if that clears your head, that may be the solution to that. So it's not an all or nothing sort of thing. These are just little tips that I've found to kind of regain that clarity when it's lost.
Thank you. And Derek, one more point about that. What should people apply for if they need help getting hand controls or minor vehicle modifications?
So Casey, that falls up under the assistive technology program. The assistive technology program runs the gamut. So maybe now is maybe a good time to kind of run down some of those things with the assistive technology program.
Yes, let's talk about what that is.
Okay. So when we talk about assistive technology, you're thinking about maybe first is durable medical equipment. Years ago, we used to call it the equipment program. And then it was, then we developed the, learned the real term was assistive technology. So I think there are like 8 different categories that fall up under the assistive technology program. So we deal with air conditioners. You deal with durable medical equipment. We also deal with home and vehicle modifications. So a lot of times you may get a power chair or scooter, but if you don't have the access, you know, they'll get it into your house, but maybe you might need a ramp to get that scooter or power chair outside of the home or maybe on your vehicle so you can be more active. So encourage you to kind of look at the different categories that we have in the assistive technology program.
Just a little hint on that as well is in our area of the country, at least, Habitat for Humanity will do the labor at no charge. You may want to make a donation to Habitat if that happens. And the foundation could provide the materials. So if things are tight financially, you might want to marry 2 programs like that and get a bigger bang for the buck.
And that is something that we really frequently do is work with other organizations. Cheryl, can you speak to that a little bit in your experience?
Yes, I also wanted to mention Home Depot. Some Home Depots also have volunteer programs. You can call and inquire, and they love to help nonprofits. So I know we have done a couple of things at times with Home Depot. So I remember doing a couple of different projects with them, and it's been really a great feeling to work with them. They love it, and we love it. I also wanted to mention regarding transportation, not only can you modify and do all the extra things through the home care grant, also if you need assistance, let's say you go into the hospital and you have any procedure done, it doesn't even have to be related to MS. As long as you have the MS diagnosis, you can call us. We do have a, what we call a coming home program. Well, that program not only will pick you up at the hospital, but it will take you if it needs to, if you can't go on the Uber, or even if you need an assistance, like an aide to go with you. An aide will go with you, get you settled there at the hospital, also will return and pick you up if it's an outpatient procedure, for example, or even if you had to stay in for 2 days, they'll get you home and they will help you get groceries for that week, or, you know, stay with you from 4 hours to maybe up to a week or two, depending on the funding we have available at that time in your area. So that is a very good coming home program. Also, we offer aides that sometimes with your home care program that will drive you to and from an appointment. If, like I said, Derek's program with the Uber and the Lyft, but if you need assistance getting in and out of the car and you need someone to sit with you at the doctor's office, at physical therapy, at, you know, whatever therapy you're going to, any of our therapies that we offer, our home care grant will offer that to you. Was that what you asked?
So let me just clarify that for our listeners. So under the transportation grant that Derek talked about, if you are able to transfer or have a caregiver that will help you transfer and accompany you, you would use the transportation program. If you need an aide to go with you to and from an appointment, then they would use the home care program. Is that correct?
Yes, I think.
Okay.
It's correct for me.
All right.
I don't know, Derek, if you also, the aides can also go with the patients with your transportation program also, correct?
They can. The only stipulation that we have, I'm sorry. The only stipulation that, yeah, if you have your own caregiver, and you have to be able to get your equipment. If you have a manual scooter, like, so you couldn't use it if you had a manual power, if you had a power chair. You can use the program for that. Although we do have, in some certain select cities, there are accessible vehicles. If Lyft has it available, they mm-hmm. will let you know in your Lyft app if they have it available.
Yes, and there's also, in some counties, paratransit, and they will, like a van, they will send a accessible van to go pick them up, you know, with the wheelchair, with the scooter. So it depends on the situation, you know, each is unique and individual. So you can always call us for us to help you and tell, and even look up resources in your area for you, in your county, so that you can access these services.
I think it's important to note too, that the driver of the vehicle cannot assist you. You have to be able to make those transfers or have somebody helping you. The paratransit driver, the Lyft driver cannot help you with transfers and is not responsible if you're unable to make it from your chair or scooter into the vehicle safely.
Thank you. Okay, Cheryl, so the other question was, can you talk a little bit about how we work with other organizations to make a grant request happen?
Sure, definitely. Especially, with both home care and emergency assistance grant, we work with other organizations. I have, right now with home care, I'm working with a lady in a very rural area of Arkansas. And she's all alone. She's 73 years old. And she's very weak. So I kind of have exhausted all my funding trying to help her, because she only has a nephew who lives kind of far away that comes in every once in a while. And this is really sad. A lot of our patients, especially a lot of elderly patients, if they don't have their own children, I used all of my funding to help her. And now what I did was I called the MS Society and I connected with her permission, with her on the line, and I connected with a navigator. We connected with a navigator who I explained the whole procedure to her, and we are now working together to give her another $2,000 of home care. So we helped her to fill out the application because she can't do any of that on her own. And so we collaborate with the MS Society, United Way, Catholic Charities, Jewish Services. Anyone that will work with us will gladly work with them to assist our clients. And so, and that's what we do. For emergency assistance grant, the same thing. If your bill, let's say you have to pay a past due utility or rent, that's, let's say, $500. We will definitely call resources in your area. We have a list of resources, and find someone else that can partner with us so that we can pay the complete bill. Because it doesn't really make sense when we just pay a part, and you, if you have a circumstance where you don't have the money, and then you're left with another half, and you're going to be back in the same position the next month. We try to work together with another organization to get that bill cleared up for you so you can start afresh the next time. I hope that's clear enough.
Okay. So thank you very much. And then there are cases where we may refer out to other organizations. For example, when we have someone who is uninsured and needs a doctor's appointment, but also an MRI. Derek, can you talk a little bit about how we might handle that and partner with MSAA and their program?
Yep, sure. So a lot of times, you know, you get clients that need either their first MRI or maybe a second or third. And I know the MS Association has a wonderful MRI program, so we definitely partner with them. And any requests that we get from our clients, we're gonna go and try to find it. So we work with tons of agencies. So we, you know, one of the first things that we start to look for is probably looking through the United Way or 211 in their area so that we can see what other resources are available in a particular city. So if you're in Chicago, we're gonna look at 211 Chicago to see what resources are available so that we can try to tackle the situation together and, you know, as a team.
All right. So let's talk a little bit about medication copays. That's certainly an area where we sometimes may refer out to other agencies, but there are circumstances in which we do handle medication copays. Cheryl, could you speak to that a little bit?
Sure. Yes, so basically any drug that is used strictly to treat MS, if you have a copayment and you have exhausted your funding for the year through another, a lot of clients have another program such as PAN. Derek, what does PAN, what do those words stand for?
The Patient Assistance Network, if I'm not mistaken.
All right, thank you so much. So yes, that's one of the larger ones that most of our clients use. But as always, most of them are just for a time. And when that exhausts, they turn to us and we then go over the application. We see that, yes, they have been in on assistance and they're just waiting for that lapse in coverage to come back, you know, into play, usually the end of the year, the beginning of the year. And so your copayment basically can be anywhere from around $35, you know, maybe, you know, up to $1,000. It's once in a lifetime. I mean, that we, well, actually we can pay up to $1,000 in a lifetime. So if you have a copayment of $75, we can do it a little bit longer if you meet all the qualifications of the program. Some people come to us and their copayment, unfortunately, is $999. So we give them that one-time assistance, but sometimes it just helps. They're waiting to start another program that will be picked up by their county, et cetera. And a lot of people are very grateful. I just received a lovely letter from a client that we assisted with $800 and something, and he was so appreciative. He's, you know, he was boasting about the coordinator Monique that helped him, and he said she went all out of her way to help him pay that copayment, and how much he appreciated. And now he's back on track. So we try our best to help with any of the disease modifying drugs to help with the copayment during that interim.
All right, thank you for that. I see Laura has a question. Laura, I'm gonna ask you to unmute. Go ahead.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
My name is Laura. I'm in Miami Beach, Florida. So we do get a lot of humidity here in the summer. But my question that I sent earlier is I've been worried about getting the vaccine for the COVID. And some people say that, some MS patients didn't really have any symptoms and others did have. I had the flu back in 2017. I ended up in the hospital with methylprednisone IV for 3 days. And so I'm very worried about the reaction I'm gonna have if I do get a vaccine. Anybody have any opinions on that?
Well, let me start, Laura, by saying I did send your question earlier to our senior medical advisor, Dr. Ben Thrower. And he responded by saying, from what I'm seeing, people with MS do not appear to be reacting any differently to the COVID vaccines than the general public. So I would not recommend taking steroids prior to a COVID vaccine for fear that they could make the vaccine less effective. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, so they're not getting symptoms, or is that what he's saying?
He's saying that they don't react any differently than anyone else. So they may get they may get the same kind of flu-like symptoms that other people are getting, but it doesn't seem to be any worse. It does seem that they resolve. Sherry, do you have anything you'd like to add? You're muted. Sherry, you're muted.
After my second dose of Moderna, it was 27 hours afterwards, I began to get chilled and couldn't get warm. And then I was too warm and I was peeling, and I finally took my temperature and it was up 4 degrees. Now, people with MS, those of us that have had it for any period of time, know that with an elevation of temperature, our MS symptoms usually tend to get worse. Mm-hmm. That did not happen. My vision did not go. The spasticity did not flare. The pain did not ramp up. I just couldn't stay awake. And so I literally went to bed and took a 3-hour nap. Woke up an hour later, my temp started coming down. I didn't take anything for it. But the fever that I had after the second COVID vaccine did not wreak the same kind of havoc in my body as an infection did. So want to assure you that it's a whole different character of response than responding to an infection. So my experience with the COVID vaccine was, yes, I did have side effects after that second dose, but it didn't impact my body like an infection does.
Oh, that's interesting.
All right. Thank you so much for your question.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for answering.
Thank you, Sherry. All right. I just want to remind our listeners that you can send questions through chat if you like, or you can raise your hand by using the raise hand button. If you are on a computer, that will be under the participants menu down at the bottom right. If you are on a mobile device, it will be under the more menu with the dot, dot, dot on the button. Okay, let's go back to our questions that were submitted in advance. So rental or utility assistance. So this is back to Cheryl. Is there anything different that's happening with the program because of COVID? Are we referring people out to other COVID resources? What's the situation there?
Definitely. Not only during COVID, but always when we get a request for assistance, we will look for other agencies that can help first in most occasions, and we will refer the client. If there's something in the area that that does the same thing like we do, because our funding is not as large as the county's funding, we definitely will refer you to that program first. And most times I ask the client to get me a letter of denial or an email from that caseworker they're working with. And they may come back and say, or even we can only do $100, and that's awesome. So we look for other agencies and we go ahead and sometimes we split it up, but definitely during COVID, there were so many different programs that we did tap into and refer our clients to. And sometimes they will say, oh no, they can't help me. And we will call ourselves when time, you know, as much as we could, and find out that yes, they do have available funds and they do exactly what we say. And then the client feels a little bit more, you know, assured, okay, let me go ahead and apply, because they get tired of so much rejection that sometimes they don't want to do it themselves. So we do encourage them to apply for everything out there before they come to us, so that way we can extend our funding to help someone else that doesn't qualify for the county program.
Okay. And yet those county programs are going to be well funded, and hopefully people qualify, but when they don't, we're here to help. All right, our next question. I see Ben has a question. Ben, I'm gonna ask you to unmute.
Hi.
Hi, what's your question?
Is there anyone in your organization that can speak about getting into Medicare and getting through all the difficulties and complexities of Medicare as they pertain to MS and all the medications for MS patients and everything else that goes with it? I'm on the verge of going on Medicare, and I'm wading through all sorts of information here, information there. Y'all have anyone that could add anything to that?
I can tell you that when I made that transition from a private insurance to Medicare, there were a lot of uncertainties. Even though I've been a nurse for years, it was difficult for me to navigate that. So I can certainly understand your concern. one of the things to consider if you're going on Medicare and you're on a disease-modifying therapy is that all of the self-administered disease-modifying therapies have huge, huge copays, where I was paying $75 a month for my injectable with private insurance. The copay when I went to Medicare was $2,200 a month, and the pharmaceutical companies cannot help you with those copays if you're on Medicare. However, the PAN, Patient Assistance Network, can, and they have a very liberal income guideline for that. It's about three times over the poverty level. So it's not real tight. And again, it's based on disposable income. As far as Medicare is concerned, most of the, throughout the country, there are persons out there that do not work, they work on commission for the different insurance companies that provide Medicare supplements. So you don't pay them, but they'll do the research for you to find out what the best program is based upon, like with your Part D for your medications, based upon the specific medications that you're taking. So that can be very helpful. And you can just go to medicare.gov and get some help with finding someone in your area who can sit down and work with you on that.
Okay.
I assume you're already on Social Security disability if you're—
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
On Social Security, I am under 65. So that kind of limits what the private insurance companies can offer.
Right.
I've been told.
It does. It limits it, but it doesn't keep you from getting those benefits. You actually pay a slightly higher premium under the age of 65. When I aged into real Medicare, I lost my Social Security disability and it just transferred to a Social Security payment. But my premiums with Medicare dropped a little bit as a result. So, you know, it's a trade-off. you still get good care with it. And I have to say that Medicare has really saved me a lot of money. It's probably saving, it probably saves about $500 or $600 a month over paying for the premium for private insurance. And I wasn't getting it through work. I was buying my insurance. So it's a saver.
The biggest thing that I'm worried about is I am on a disease modifying therapy of Ocrevus. Mm-hmm. And I know it is covered.
It's covered because you get it in an infusion center. So your Medicare Part B will cover it. Part B is about $135 premium per month.
Okay.
It's the infusible. So it's the Lemtrada, the Ocrevus, the Rituxan, and the Tysabri. They're all covered if you're on Medicare because they're done in an infusion center. They're not self-administered.
You know what kind of weight you just lifted off my shoulders?
To have done that.
We knew that the Part B would cover the infusion, but there was still question about the Ocrevus.
The actual medication. my Part D bows to Part B. So I don't have to pay for my Rituxan infusions, which are almost identical to Ocrevus. They are, however, about a third the cost per dose. So
you're getting Part D because you're over 65.
Oh, no. Anytime you're on Medicare, you got to get Part D. If you don't have Part D, you actually get fined if there's a need for medication. And the Part D policies are not expensive. They run anywhere from my policy this year, because I'm on so many specialty medications for other conditions, I'm only paying like $7.20 a month for the premium. There are nice Part D policies out there that have lower co-pays that you might pay $35 a month. So again, getting somebody from the insurance company to sit down and talk with you that's familiar with the different Medicare products can be very helpful.
Okay.
I also want to add for you, Mr. Leach, that the MS Society, they have a legal department. You can call and ask for an MS navigator and discuss with her that you have some legal questions going into Medicare, and they will assist you. I just found out recently about how much they do and the fact that they do have a legal department that can also assist you with any legal questions. Okay,
I'm writing all this down.
Do you have the number? And of course, I think do you have the number to the MS Society?
Yeah, I've got it.
Great, okay.
Derek, anything you wanna add on this topic of making decisions about Medicare?
No, I think Sherry and Cheryl were, kind of dead on with the response. But Ben, anytime you want to call, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to give us a shout at the foundation.
So that last question was about doctors.
For doctor's visits.
Visiting doctors. How can we help with that, Derek?
Paying for the doctor's visit. So we do have a program that can assist our healthcare assistance program. So that program was developed for clients that kind of fall in the gap where they don't have insurance. So what we do is we partner with the neurologist's office to provide a visit and a copay visit for the year. And then what we try to do to kind of accompany that is to help them where they can have some type of insurance. And again, we, we'll refer them to healthcare.gov to see what plans are available to them so that they can kind of continue on that care plan.
Okay. All right, folks, well, that just about wraps up our time today. I want to thank all of you who were here, who participated, who gave us your time and your attention. We appreciate you so much. And a special thank you to our panelists, Cheryl Patterson, Derek Lee, and Sherry Benz. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge with everyone here today.
Before we go, I just want to say that I just received an email from Alan letting us know that he received a donation for our quality of life programs. And he basically asked you and I, Derek, which ones need more funds. So I already opened my mouth for home care and he just answered and said he's adding 20,000 to that program. So anyone that needs home care on here, this is a good time to apply. So thank you everyone. And we're here to help you if you need us.
All right, any final thoughts from our other panelists?
I think just know that we're here for you, even though we're not working out of the office per se like we used to. And if you've got questions for any of us, support@msfocus.org, email. And they'll, and if there's a specific person that you need to talk to, let them know and they'll get in touch with us and we can reach out to you. And we're happy to do that.
And you can always find Sherry through our Facebook groups. We have two groups, one that's public and open for anyone to join in and see the information that's shared, and one that's private, the MS Confidential, which is just for people with MS. And anything posted there won't show up on your own feed where your friends and family members are going to see it. So it's a great place to ask questions that, you know, you need that safety and comfort to ask that question. Deborah, did you have something you wanted to add?
Yes, actually, Ben, I've been in your place where I'm trying to jot everything down really, really fast and make sure that I get all the information correct. And I know Casey generally mentions this if she hasn't already, but everything we've been talking about, minus the pranksters, which will be cut out, everything is going to be on our YouTube channel in less than 2 weeks. So you can just read it at your pace over and over again and jot it down as you want, because I know that feeling of, oh my God, I just missed a few words that were important. So not only that, but you can go onto our website and it'll be eventually put onto the SoundCloud for there also. So it's really nice. Everything here is there and you don't have to worry about going so fast, okay? I just wanted to mention that.
Absolutely. All of our educational programs are recorded and are available on the Multiple Sclerosis Foundation YouTube channel. You can just go to YouTube and type in Multiple Sclerosis Foundation. And then if you hit subscribe, which of course is free, it will just give you notifications every time that we post something new. And we do also share the audio content, as Deborah said, through our SoundCloud page and on msfocusradio.org, which is a mobile app of streaming radio that plays MS educational content 24/7. You can take it on the road with you and listen anytime. I also want to let you know about our next teleconference. Our next conference will be on May 6th at 2 p.m. with Adam Chaffetz, and it will be discussing the use of chiropractic care in the management of MS. So we hope you'll be able to join us for that. You can find more information by following us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, any of our social media platforms, or that information will also shortly be up on our website under the events section. So again, thank you so much, all of you, for joining us today, for participating. We appreciate you. We're here for you. And we hope to see you again. Goodbye.
Bye.